Welcome to another episode of Quest4Truth. It has been a long time since we've had our last show. We've been super busy with just many projects, but we're excited to be back. We plan to continue this show as long as we possibly can until the Lord comes. We hope to finish it soon before he comes. Although, if he wants to come sooner, we're okay with that, too. But we're enjoying our study through the book of Revelation. And great to be back with you. Hey, Rob, great to see you, man.
Yeah, great to see you, too. You know, it's kind of funny. It is taking us forever to get through the book of Revelation. It may end up, you know, whenever the rapture is, we may get to that part of Revelation when he actually shows up at this rate. It's kind of taking forever. But, yeah, we've both been really busy, and you know, but it's great to be back, and this is our 20th episode, man. Episode 20.
It's amazing.
So
it's,
I figured, you know,
it's gone fast but kind of slow. I mean, we've taken our time.
Yeah,
we made it.
20 episodes. We're just now getting ready to go into Revelation chapter 6. Some of these episodes we get through like two verses, you know, but you know, I thought this is. And he kind of hit pause on our Revelation study and let our viewers and listeners know what we're planning with Quest4Truth, because we have some pretty cool things in the works.
Yes, we do.
There are some other guys that we have traveled the speaking circuit with, like Doug Woodward and Gon Shimura and Doug Krieger. And these are just a few guys that we've been talking with kind of off the air and brainstorming a little bit about ways for us to expand the Quest4Truth brand. And so far, it's just really been you and I, but we were thinking, you know, we'd like to do more conferences, you know, during the year and do other shows, other studies, you know, with other guys. And you know, you and I started this because based on the fact that we don't necessarily agree on everything. And while we found with some of the other speakers, we don't all agree either, but we all love each other, we all respect each other, and we thought, you know what? What if we could really expand this whole idea and talk about all kinds of things? And so Gary Winkleman is also coming on board, sort of to help us on the business side of things. And John DeBartolo, maybe you could talk a little bit more about him. I met him for the first time at the conference out in California earlier. Was that this year or last year? I forget what it was. It was this year, right? Earlier this year?
This was this year, yeah. Yeah, man. Back in Westminster in February, yeah.
Yeah, I met
John
him.
And I hosted that, and that was really fun.
I met him at the dinner that we had afterwards, but how do you know him?
Oh, I met him, you know, really online, and he is the founder, one of the co-founders of the Middle Earth Network, which is a network of websites that are all about Tolkien and C.S. Lewis and, you know, a lot of fantasy genre writings and such. And so we talked about him publishing my new book, The Millennium Chronicles. And so that's how I got started, and he and his partner, Mark Raymond, came out, and we had a good time talking, and so we have a lot of things in the works there as well.
Yeah, I really enjoyed meeting with him and talking with him about all of the Lord of the Rings stuff. This guy, he's like the go-to guy when it comes to Tolkien and the whole Lord of the Rings thing. So we're excited to be talking with him about possibly doing a conference up in New York, right?
That is the plan. We hope to do that in either September or October. We're trying to figure out the exact dates. Of course, we have to find the right venue. But we believe that could be a very positive kind of conference. According to John, he says he really hasn't seen many end times prophecy conferences take place in New York. You know, I can't attest to that. But if that's the case, then this is something that is greatly needed, so that people can come up to speed on what prophecy is all about and the exciting developments that we see happening in the world around us. You know, not only do we want to sort of take the newspaper and show you what's happening, but we want to show you what the Bible says, more importantly, what the Bible has to say about it, and just give at least a very big trend. We want to use it also as an evangelistic tool. We believe that there are a lot of people that are not Christians that have questions, whether it be about the supernatural in general They may be having some questions, who is this Antichrist I keep hearing about, if they've heard at all, if they've even wondered. But there are people that are asking questions, and we want to be there to answer these questions in a non-threatening but very informative and even entertaining sort of way. And we want to make it accessible while not arguing on some of the minutia of prophecy, and prophecy teachers have a tendency to focus on those things, and they can be fun discussions, but they're not always really suitable for a non-Christian audience. And so that's what we want to try to do, is look at some of the bigger topics so that we can get the non-Christians interested, because we think it's very, very important and interesting as well.
Yeah, I'm really excited about that. Earlier this year, just a couple months ago, I guess, I did my first secular conference. All the conferences that I've done so far have been in front of the church, Christian audiences and stuff like that. But I got to do the, I think it was the 54th annual UFO conference up in New Jersey. David Stinnett brought me up there, and Sheila and I. And it was all the Ancient Aliens crowd that was there. it was Nick Redford and guys like that have been on Ancient Aliens. And so it was kind of cool. I was sort of like the token Christian there, but it was neat to rub shoulders with these guys, because they're even coming to some of the same conclusions that so-called ET is not necessarily from Arcturus or Orion or the Pleiades, but rather that we're dealing with interdimensional beings. And so, interestingly enough, here's these guys coming from really kind of a secular worldview, coming to very similar conclusions to what you and I believe. And so, being able to share that with a secular audience was really cool. And it was actually quite amazing how much our talks really dovetailed one into the other. So, I know you have an evangelistic heart. I have an evangelistic heart. Our great commission is to go into the world. Nothing in the scriptures tells the world to come to the church. We're supposed to go out to the world. So as you and I were talking about our name, Quest4Truth, it's generic enough that it can involve just about everything, because everybody in some way, shape, or form is on a quest for truth. And so we're hoping that we'll be able to do more secular type conferences, get other speakers in, of course not compromise our message, talk about what we believe from our worldview, but expand it and have other guests, maybe other people on our show.
Yeah, I think it'd be very exciting. I think that we can really go a long way with this, and I believe that people are going to be very excited about it. We want to use this as a platform to reach the world for the gospel. You and I have a real love and affinity for prophecy, but we know that prophecy is only one part of this bigger message. I think it's unfortunate when people teach the Bible and they leave prophecy out, because that's a major no-no, right? Because approximately one-third of the Bible is about prophecy. So obviously the Lord has put a lot of stock in us knowing that. But on the other hand, we don't want to only focus on the prophecy and neglect the other stuff. And it really has to be a complete package. And so as we are on this quest for truth, not only Bible prophecy truth, but things that are relating to the common day experience of other people around the world, we think this can be a great opportunity and platform to do that.
Yeah, excellent. And I forgot to mention another individual that we've been talking with, John Holler. I don't really know him. I don't know a whole lot about him. Can you tell us a little bit more about John?
Well, John is an attorney. He lives in, I believe, Ohio. That's right, lives in Ohio, Columbus, Ohio. He's a great guy. He put on a conference over there back in, I think, March. And, again, he just has a real love for prophecy. He's excited about this growing, and so he wants to be part of this as well.
Yeah, that's real exciting. I remember seeing in one of your correspondences, you're like, I have certain gifts and abilities, but administration's not really one of them. And I had to laugh when you said that, because I'm like, yeah, that's me too. There's a conference that I do here once a month or every other month or so here in Dallas, and part of part three, it's a 3-weekend deal. The third weekend, I teach a section on spiritual gifts. And whenever I get to the one that's administration, I'm like, you know what? That's it. For me, it's a learned skill. I mean, you learn stuff like that in the Army and whatnot. I can certainly do administration, but it is not a gift. And I've learned that, you know, I operate very well in my gifting, and I operate pretty good in my skill, acquired skill sets. But when I'm operating in skill sets, man, my energy level goes, it just drains me so fast. You know, whereas if I'm in the gifts, I just flows. I can stay up all night long. So, you know, I laughed when you said that, because I'm like, you know, if somebody puts me in that position, it's sort of like the Peter principle. You've just promoted me to my highest level of incompetency. It's probably, I might get the job done, but man. So I'm really excited to have guys like John and Gary and, you know, some of these other guys. That's their gifting. That's where they operate in their gifts. And, you know, I think that the team that's being pulled together already is just outstanding.
Absolutely. Yeah, we also want to have this more of an interactive with the audience so that people can not only write in, but we can have some kind of a message board system and they can, you know, contact us while we're doing the show. So this would be both a show and a conference. In fact, we have a show lined up that we're pretty excited about. We're going to call it The Last Word, and it will be kind of a... You know, a couple of years ago, you and I did this thing where we were basically pitted against each other on the question of, you know, one incursion or two. And it was a lot of fun. That's what really got us started on this show. And so the idea would be to have basically, you know, four men, you know, one in each corner, and that we would, you know, throw a bone out there, throw out some topic, you know, the rapture. We could throw out, you know, incursions, or we could, you know, or something a little more mainstream theologically. You know, we can talk about the place of the law in the believer's life, right? You know, this kind of stuff. And then hash it out, really. And the idea is it's almost like a game show where we're actually trying to better one another. We're trying to beat one another, really, and to get the last word. So we think it could be a really fun format to talk about a lot of, you know, somewhat dry but important theological topics, but to put them in a context where it becomes a lot of fun to talk about it, and whoever can best defend their position will actually win the point. And so we have some pretty good ideas on that.
Yeah, for sure. Definitely looking forward to that. And I'm also looking forward to the whole idea of reaching a new audience. You know, some of the other conferences that we've gone to, kind of the average age is, you know, 50 and up. For some of these things, you know, a lot of these conferences are bringing in a little bit of the younger crowd, but I think it's really cool that we're actually specifically targeting the younger generation, and Gons, I think, is going to really go a long way in helping us do that, because he's in that younger generation now. You know, it's funny, I watched some of our archive shows of Quest4Truth, and this is Grecian formula. So it's funny, because you can see where it wears out. You know, it's like, you know, sometimes you see an episode, I look nice and young and all dark, and then there's other ones like, dude, you're like Santa Claus going on there, you know. So, you know, I've certainly got the gray going on. I don't know if you do. If you do, you're hiding it pretty well. But, you know, this whole thing comes in Santa Claus white. So, you know, to be able to have a young face and somebody who's in that generation, who understands that generation, on board is going to really go a long way into helping us. And, of course, Gons is going to be working on our website and coming up with new ideas of being interactive and stuff like that, and integrating, to some degree, Canary Cry, just as I'm going to be also integrating the radio show that I do, the Revolutionary Radio Project, and sort of, you know, bringing, you know, we're all kind of doing our own thing over here and doing our own thing over there, but finding ways of bringing it together, and, you know, kind of under the umbrella of, hey, we're all on a quest for truth. None of us have the corner on truth. We're just trying to figure stuff out. But and like you said earlier, we want to welcome the audience in to be a little bit more, you know, interactive with us. And you know what's cool is we're going to get to sort of test this out tonight, for one thing. We'll get to that in a few minutes. But also in Austin next month, I'm going to put up a screenshot here of a website called the Back to the Future Conference. It's backtothefutureconference.com. And John Gabrielson is our contact person there in Austin. And this is the website, pretty cool. July 25th and 26th is the dates coming up. And it's you and I, and Doug Woodward's going to be joining us there. So that's pretty exciting. He's gonna be there with us. And John, when he was putting this whole thing together, had an idea about us doing a Quest for Truth Live. So this is the Quest for Truth episode 20 that we're doing right now, sort of a special edition. And Lord willing, you know, if we can get a few episodes, you and I, knocked out between now and then, maybe in July, this can be Quest for Truth episode 25, where we bring the audience in. It's a pretty packed schedule, as you can see here. But at the very end of it, they've got closing session 8, Rob Skiba, Doug Hamp, and Doug Woodward, Quest for Truth Live Q&A. So this is what we're going to get to do some interaction with the audience right there, and hopefully, if things work out well, do a an actual episode and record it live if we can get all our streaming and everything and webcams working properly. Hopefully, that's the beginning of something really cool that we can continue to do maybe as we travel.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it, totally. So I think that's great. But, yeah, well, you know, hopefully we can, you know, get this thing kicked off the ground really well, and we'll go from there. So,
yeah. Awesome. Well, I'll just do a kind of a quick run through of what we're going to talk about in Austin and get people excited about it. Hopefully, they'll start. If you guys listening to this, watching this, will start telling your friends about it. Maybe we can have a really big conference there in Austin. I'm pretty sure that the facility that John has for us can hold quite a few people. So we'd love to pack the house out if we can. It looks like I'm kicking the session off. I'm going to go ahead and put that back on the screen share there. Looks like I'm kicking the session off, opening session 1 with the Archon Invasion. What I'll probably do is my talk on Archon Invasion 2045 and the Quest for Immortality. In that particular lecture, I start back in Genesis 6 and work all the way up to the year 2045, so cover a lot of ground in that one. Then in session 2, Doug Woodward's going to be talking about the Blood Moons, which is a very timely discussion, certainly. We've got another one coming up during the Feast of Sukkot later this year. And then looks like in session 2, you're going to be talking about corrupting the image. You want to talk a little bit about what parts of that you're going to cover?
Well, it will be basically taking a look at the Nephilim, and also with the coming of the Mark of the Beast. So I'll be looking at those two topics.
Excellent. So we'll have a little bit of overlap there. That'll be pretty cool. Session 3, Doug Woodward is going to be talking about Lying Wonders of the Red Planet. That's his new book that he has out, and I've talked with him about that on my radio show. Fascinating stuff, a lot of very intriguing things he's going to have to talk about with that, which may actually be a good setup for my talk after that, the updated version of mythology and the coming Great Deception, which I did out there at the California conference. I inserted some of the new material that I put in the updated version of my book, specifically dealing with NASA and occult connections and stuff involved with the space program in NASA. And then you're coming up on session 4 with the Millennium Chronicles Part 1. What's that about?
Well, the Millennium Chronicles is all about the time after the 1,000 years of the millennium, of course, and I wrote the book as a novel, but it's chock full of Bible truth, and I also have 3 accompanying DVDs that go with it, 3 PowerPoint presentations. The first one is really all about the second coming of Jesus, because in order to understand the millennium, you have to understand what happens at the second coming, and so I'm very excited about that. I think it's a topic that, you know, the time has come for us to really dig into this stuff and to see specifically what happens at the second coming. What I find is that many teachers gloss right over the details that are very much in Scripture, and a lot of it has to do with how they approach the book of Revelation itself. If they take it as a thematic approach or chronological is going to make all the difference. So, so the big concept is the veil between heaven and earth, and I show what it looks like when it passes away. I show what is going to happen, this incredible battle that will ensue, and it's very exciting. So it's the second coming of Christ and the Battle of Armageddon, and then I, you know, I go into the details of the millennium itself and many exciting things, you know. And again, we have to be willing to take a fresh look at some of the verses that we've held most dear, such as heaven, right? And I talk about the new Jerusalem. I mean, when Jesus talks about going to prepare a place for us, he's not talking about heaven. He's talking about the new Jerusalem. Mm. And there really is a distinction, because in the popular understanding of most Christians, we think of heaven as this dimensional place that's, you know, it's dimensionally separated from where we are today. It's not attached to planet Earth, and that we're going to be living in this, you know, in this city forever, which, of course, we will be in the city, there's no question, but the city comes down to planet Earth, you know? I mean, that's a pretty major thing, right, when the city comes down to planet Earth. So we're not going to be out yonder, living out there, right? We're going to be here, and the new Jerusalem, which is heaven, will literally come down to planet Earth, and the two become one. And, you know, so there's so many verses that we need to understand, you know, where Jesus says he reconciled all things in heaven and on earth by his blood. And I'm like, wow, that's pretty huge, you know, that, you know, things in heaven were irreconciled with the things on earth, but his blood has now reconciled those things so that they can now dwell together again. And that is part of the exciting, you know, thing that Jesus did on the cross. I mean, the cross did so many things. It was not only to pay for my sin, but it was also to reconcile the two domains of where God is and where planet Earth is, and then to bring those back together again.
You know, I'm glad you brought that up, because that was sort of a paradigm shift in my thought process as well, as I started really diving into the book of Revelation on my own. I mean, we all approach, like we've talked about it before, we all approach the scriptures, to some degree anyway, with the lenses that we've been given based on the teachings that we've heard and the songs that we've sung, you know, like, this earth is not my home, I'm just a passing through, and blah, blah, blah. You know, everybody's all thinking we're going to heaven, but as I'm looking at the scriptures, I'm going, well, not really. I mean, if we do go to heaven, it's sort of a pit stop. I mean, we're not going to be there long, because this is our ultimate destination. I mean, heaven comes down, New Jerusalem comes down, God comes down, he comes here, and it's like, well, actually, this earth is my home. you know, the current state that we're in right now is going to get wiped out and, you know, get a remake, but God created this place for us with the intention of him coming from his domain into our domain and walking in the cool of the day like he did with Adam and Eve in the garden. So that's always been his plan, and when he kind of resets everything, we're here. So this earth actually is my home, and, you know, I'm looking forward to the remake. So that's all the kind of stuff you're going to talk about in that part one?
Yeah, well, part one and two and then eventually three, I get into, you know, varying degrees, and you know, it's such a paradigm shift. I use verse after verse after verse to show that, you know, I'm not just making this up, but this is throughout Scripture. But a lot of it, you know, as you know, you and I have been looking at this idea of replacement theology, and to some degree dispensationalism, mm-hmm. has clouded our view, so that we don't see it quite as well. But really, the timing of the new heavens and earth, that's a major, major, major key. And as we continue to go through the book of Revelation, we're gonna come back to that question, especially, of course, when we get to Revelation chapter 20 and 21. But the timing of the new heavens and earth is just, it changes everything. And so that is what I want people to see. And I want to show them to the nth degree what Scripture actually says about it.
Fantastic. And that closes out the Friday session. That's the end of the night right there. So you'll close us out. And then Saturday morning, wow, doors open 7:30 a.m. Oh, man, they're killing me. I'm a late nighter, man. I'm a go to bed at 4 o'clock in the morning and wake up at noon kind of guy. But it won't be that day anyway. It's July 26th. I'm starting off at 8 a.m. Oh, boy, talking about the Mount Hermon-Roswell connection. And, of course, I'll be drawing the parallels between what took place in Genesis chapter 6 and what took place in Roswell, New Mexico in 1947. And, of course, drawing on the work of David Flynn, who was really the one who made that big connection. And, of course, giving credit where credit is due, he's got a lot to say about that. And so I'll be kind of tying those dots together. Then Doug Woodward's going to be talking about America, Nazis and the final Babylon. So that should be interesting and probably a really good tie-in. It looks like John's really put some thought into this, because all of these talks really do seem to dovetail one into the other quite well. Then we have our lunch break, and then come back, and you're talking about Millennium Chronicles Part 2. What specifically will be in Part 2?
Well, I show that the New Jerusalem, first of all, I show the new heavens and earth, how that does happen at the beginning of the millennium. I also show what the New Jerusalem, what the shape of it is. It's not actually a cube, but it's a pyramid, and that has some pretty interesting implications. And I talk about who is the bride. You know, the bride is actually the New Jerusalem, not the church specifically. And I, you know, of course, I get into lots of detail about that. But so that's pretty much for part two there.
Okay. Then Doug Woodward's going to be talking about blood on the altar. I'm not actually familiar with that talk, so I don't know what that's about. So I'll be looking forward to hearing that. Then session 7, I'll be talking about 3-2-2 tetrads and the time of Jacob's trouble, and that's where I'll probably kind of piggyback on Doug's previous talk on the blood moons, talk a little bit about that, how I believe all this stuff relates to the numbers 3-2-2 and secret societies and things of that nature, and my take on the time of Jacob's trouble and the reason why I believe we may actually have about 19 more years to go, at least, before all this comes to an end. So I'll be discussing that, and then you'll be wrapping up our lectures with the Millennium Chronicles Part 3, and what's that about?
Well, it's called the Final Rebellion, and it really is the culmination of the millennium. It's the time after the millennium when Satan gets out. He goes out to deceive the nations, and I talk about, you know, first of all, you know, how he could possibly do that, but also what are the conditions of the mortals versus the immortals. That's a very important distinction, because there will be two kinds of people at that point. Either you have your new body or you don't have your new body. And if you don't have your new body, what is life like for you? And how can you get your new body as well? You know, today we believe by faith in something we cannot see, and only upon either death or resurrection, or, you know, rapture, or I should say, do we have the opportunity to receive our new body. But somebody in that age, you know, there will not be a resurrection. There will be a means by which they can go and get their new body, and Scripture has quite a bit to say about that. I talk about the Millennium Temple and the Millennium Sacrifices and what those sacrifices are all about, what is the importance of those. And then when Satan finally goes and he deceives the nations, and basically what his strategy is, you know, it seems kind of crazy that, you know, after 1,000 years that he would actually think that he could go and deceive the nations and have any kind of chance to beat God. But, you know, this all makes sense in Satan's mind. And so I kind of get into his mind a little bit and talk about what his most likely strategy is.
Wow, very interesting stuff. I'll be looking forward to that, because I've got a lot of questions in that, all of that, and I've got some theories as well, so I'd like to hear what you have to say, and then maybe that'll spin a whole show off in and of itself, depending on what, you know, what our views are on that. And then we go into closing session at 7:30 p.m., we will have Quest4Truth live with the audience, where you, Doug Woodward, and I will hash it out with each other and with the audience. So that should be really exciting. We haven't done anything like that yet so far, and I'm looking forward to that for sure. And tonight, we're going to do something very similar. The last few weeks on the Revolutionary Radio Project, I didn't have any guests lined up, so I decided, I'm going to try something new and try the open lines kind of thing, like on Coast to Coast, AM they used to do with Art Bell. And so I did. I opened up the phone lines, and it's kind of like, Forrest Gump. You never know what you're going to get. You have no idea what people are going to call in with. But it was a lot of fun, and the audience loved it. I was able to get to about 6 or 7 connect with Doug Woodward yet today. He was supposed to join us on this Google Hangout, but hopefully he'll be able to join us tonight on the Revolutionary Radio Project. But one way or another, we are still going to do open lines, and I'm going to play the audio from what we're doing right now to set it all up. We'll be there to do Quest4Truth live on the Revolutionary Radio Project tonight at 10 p.m. Central Standard Time. We'll get started. So looking forward to that.
Very cool. So we want to encourage people to join us if you're able in Austin. Also join us for the rest of the Book of Revelation as we go through it. We're going to have a great time when we get into the meat in Chapter 6. So that's it for me, Rob. Anything else?
No, that's it for me as well. Awesome. So please keep us in your prayers as we're working together to try to expand the Quest4Truth brand and get more speakers involved and get you involved. So please keep us in your prayers as we are, working out the logistics for all that. But exciting things are in store for us. So we're looking forward to it.
After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill. The story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to be. You take the red pill. You stay in Wonderland. And I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. You're listening to the Revolutionary Radio Project. With your host, Rob Skiba. All I'm offering is the truth.
Hello and welcome to the Revolutionary Radio Project. I am your host, Rob Skiba, and I'm really excited about tonight's show. Hopefully everything will go well, and if it does, I think you guys are in for a treat. I have Doug Woodward with me here now. I'm going to go ahead and bring him up live, and I have Doug Hamp on there as well. So welcome, gentlemen.
Hey, great to be there.
Hey guys, boy, some exciting stuff, man. I'm really, really just totally jazzed, as Russ Dizdar would say, about the whole idea of expanding Quest4Truth, making it a lot bigger than it is right now, and bringing a lot of other people into the mix. And Doug Woodward is one of those administrative type guys who's sort of acting as, I guess, what kind of temporary president at the moment. Is that your title?
Chief bottle washer and cook, I think it's probably better. But I've done a lot of my day job for most of the last 20 years has been working with startup companies and entrepreneurs, and so I'm kind of used to doing business plans and financial models and things like that. And so there's sort of a business element that we do have to put together, and so I'm happy to put my effort into that, because it's something I know how to do.
It looks like you're doing it well. Our inboxes are filling up with Excel spreadsheets and Word docs and all that kind of stuff, but pretty exciting. And why don't you tell our listeners how many conferences we're actually hoping to start doing every year?
Yeah, well, certainly a minimum of 4 and probably 5 or 6. It it really depends upon a variety of things, and part of it is kind of how fast we can get our act together. We have to have a little bit of operating capital, a little bit of a donation, a few donations up front, and once we get that going, that will help. We'll probably have to limit the size of the attendees in the first year, just because the bigger the venue you get, the more risk you run in terms of trying to fill it up and hotel rooms you have to book and all that. But we're hoping to be able to have venues where we can accommodate as many as 600 people and then really do it all over the country, California, Washington, D.C., somewhere, we talked about Austin, Texas. That's kind of already in the plan, and we're kicking this off with that next month. But we plan to be in a number of places, and then we'll also stream some of these, and we'll also have DVDs that'll be recorded, edited, and made available. So we should really, our goal is to reach as many people as tens of thousands of people, and to do this on an annualized basis, kind of set up tours and kind of repeat it again and again as the years go on until the Lord comes.
Right on. Yeah, we got some people in the chat room saying, darn it, I'm in South Africa. but you know what? I think I can speak for all of us. Invite us and we will come. Of course, that would mean an airplane ticket and lodging too, but we would definitely go to South Africa.
If you think about, the big picture, you need basically, we need someplace to sleep, right? We need a little food, and we need a ticket to get there. So obviously the plane tickets are going to be the most expensive, but if we were to keep it to, a handful of people, say a handful of speakers, it wouldn't be outrageous, and we'd be happy to come. We want to, not just preach to the choir. We want this to be bigger. That was the original vision that I was sharing with John DiBartolo. He's one of our main guys. He's in New York, and that's where we're hoping to have the first conference. And we've been just, throwing around some ideas. But the basic theme seems to be supernatural. And, maybe we'll call it the Supernatural Conference. We haven't chosen an absolute title yet. But the idea is that we would like the non-believer to show up to this. And we want to touch on, not only the Nephilim or the aliens. Those are fun topics, no question. But we believe that there's so many other topics, such as spiritum issues, dead relatives, paranormal ghosts, demons, aliens, Nephilim, heaven, the afterworld, Israel, conspiracies of different natures. And so we want this to be an opportunity for maybe a Christian to bring a non-Christian. So, we're not just debating the in-house issues. The one that always comes up is the timing of the rapture. And that's a fun discussion. But a non-believer is going to be like, what's the rapture? Like, what are you guys arguing about? And I think we lose them immediately if that's what we focus on. We can have that conversation another time. But what we want to get out to the world is that the Bible and prophecy are relevant for their lives. It really does make a difference what we see in scriptures, and it helps them to interpret and translate the events that are going on in our world. When you look at Iran, you look at Iraq right now, and you say, goodness, what's this, what's happening? Does the world have anything to say about it? Or transhumanism, or any number of topics. Those are the kinds of things that we want to share with people at these conferences so that they will go away not just with some cool facts, but with some very practical information that they can apply to their lives and as Christians that they can share with non-believers as well.
Yeah, exactly. I think we want to really make sure that we're not just sort of talking amongst ourselves, but we really are trying to be relevant. And there's you and I and Rob, we all disagree on certain things, but we agree on many of the core things, and we all agree that it's important that we articulate the gospel of Jesus Christ in terms that our culture, our contemporary our contemporaries will understand and be interested in. And so I think we all share that common conviction, which is really at the heart of what we want to do. We really want this to be not just teaching, but very much about evangelism.
Yes, evangelism and getting a lot more interactive. A lot of people have questions. A lot of people want to discuss these things too. And that's sort of the goal for tonight, is to do a live Q&A, kind of kick that off for Quest4Truth. And I've got a few people lined up in the chat room already here and in the studio. And I believe this is area code 317. I believe this is Chad, if I'm not mistaken. Chad.
Yes,
hey,
sir.
Buddy.
Yes, sir. Hi. How you doing, Rob?
Good, man. You got a question for any of us?
Yes, I do. Doug Hamp. Been wanting to talk to you for a while. You're a hard guy to nail down, man. But this one may be one that you'll want to look at and come back to you first, though. And I know you guys are talking about the rapture, and I'm kind of sick of that topic too myself. But I came upon something that in the little Scott, Greek lexicon that has really got me scratching my head, because it seems to me, unfortunately, that everything online is inextricably linked to Strong's. So any time that I've looked at this online, it has linked me to the Strong's, and I don't want to see the Strong's. I wanted to see it in the original Greek.
Yeah.
And so I finally got a hold of one, and I looked, and I've come across something. I mentioned this, Rob, at a Virtual House Church not long ago. So you can look at this, and maybe you can come back to answering me, but it's always given this word harpazo. Now, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe my eyes are sore, but that is not the word that I see there in the original Greek. I see a different word there, which is harpaje. I'm not even sure I'm pronouncing it right. But in that verse in 1 Thessalonians, if you could look at that for me in your little Scott and tell me if I'm in fact seeing a word that is not, it's also in Strong's. I think Strong's harpazo is like 726 or something like that. But harpaje is also in Strong's, and that is the word that I'm seeing there. Maybe you can look at it. Having the background, and tell me if I'm seeing that wrong. That's my question. I'll leave it alone. Maybe you can come back to it. But if you could look at that and tell me if I'm seeing that wrong, I would appreciate it. That's it.
Right, yeah. Well, the main difference is just between, it's just how you want, you put it in a different, you know, the Greek lexicons have all the verbs in the first person singular.
Okay.
And so, you know, so that's what's happening there. But it's going to be declined as something else. It's called the declension, or, you know, basically how you conjugate it within the sentence.
Okay.
So, you know, I think that is probably what you're looking at. I'm actually pulling up the Liddell and Scott. By the way, this is a great time for a free commercial for the Word Bible software. Amazing stuff.
Uh-huh.
I don't know if you happen to use that, but it has Liddell and Scott, and it doesn't depend solely on the Strong's, because I think Strong's is many times kind of weak myself.
Well,
and,
yeah, you know, early on, I'm not putting it down by no means. I mean, I have one. I bought one for like $10 some 20, 25 years ago. But I've heard so many people who understand the language say, look at it in the original and work that way, not backwards. And so I've been trying to do that more so. My problem is not having the education in Greek. It takes me quite a lot longer to work that way, but I'm understanding more from it. But this one just really had me intrigued, because the word I kept seeing linked is not the word I was seeing looking at it in the original Greek. It was a different word according to what I was seeing. So I needed some input to help me understand what I was seeing.
Right. Right. Well, you know, I'm looking at the word harpazo right now in the Liddell and Scott, And it means to snatch away, to carry off, to steal, to be a thief, to seize hastily, snatch up. And it's used in a bunch of different writings. It's used in Homer. It's used in Herodotus.
Right.
It's used in Aeschylus. And, again, Euripides. You know, it's all over the place. This word is used.
Right.
So
and then
you were
word,
asking about... Yeah.
That word that I'm seeing in the original Greek there is harpaje, which... In Strong's, it says it means to plunder, to ruin.
Harpage. Okay.
Right.
It's longer than that. It's a harpage somitha, or something like that.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Yeah. That,
Well, you see my problem.
I do. Yes, I do. Yeah, I do. That's...
Because that root is used elsewhere, along with harpazo. I mean, harpazo is translated differently in various places in the original Greek throughout the scriptures, too, that's translated differently. So that's what really caused my consternation. Why if they are used in different places more closely to their meaning, why here... was one that is clearly used elsewhere, translated this way, when it's clearly a different word in the original Greek.
Right. You know, I have to take a look at that. It's a very good question, and I don't have
I kind of knew that you would have to come back to this, so I'm not upset about that. But I this is the place where I could pin you down. and get you to look at that. So thank
awesome.
You so much for your time.
Cool.
My pleasure.
Thanks, Chet.
Yeah, it's an excellent question. My goodness. Gee, I don't know. There must be something here that I'm missing. So I have to just, I'm going to think about this for a second. So.
Okay, what about Doug Woodward? Have you looked at that at all, or is that something you haven't looked at either?
Listen, when it comes to languages, I am outclassed by Brother Hamp here. So, now there's a few languages, sections, of Scripture that Doug Hamp and I have wrestled a bit over regarding the meaning of the Hebrew and so forth. But he's the expert. I'm just the novice, but I try.
Yeah, right on. All right. Well, we have another caller in the queue here from area code 607. Who do I have here?
Sherry.
Sherry?
Sherry. Did you get that?
Terry or Sherry? I didn't hear.
Terry, I think. Hi, Terry.
Okay.
Sherry.
Sherry.
Sherry. Sherry.
There we go. Sherry. Yeah, Sherry, what's your...
Okay. Actually, I got a few. Earlier today, I had a very in-depth, interesting conversation with a young, very young girl who is into the whole mixture of biblical scriptures and mixing in transhumanism. And I've noticed this a lot there, the scripture where it talks about seeing through spiritual eyes and stuff like that. That there's a lot of people attributing that to, what is it, Buddhism? Is that the one that does the whole chakras and things like that?
Well, chakras, I suppose maybe Buddhism, but I mean, that's Hindu mostly.
Is that what it is?
Yeah.
She was saying that it was biblical, and I tried to explain to her. I don't know if she is actually listening to this or not. I hope she is, but I would like to put in a clear warning out there about she had posted a comment back to me supposedly channeling God, and immediately Jeremiah popped up in my head about the warning about false prophets, those who dream. So as I was reading through this, through Jeremiah 5, in Jeremiah 14. Then there was in Zechariah, then in Joel, about people who dream dreams. It made me think about what is found in, Jude chapter 1. Is it Jude chapter 1?
There's only one chapter of Jude.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You can't go wrong with that.
Can't go wrong with that one.
Yeah, it was actually Acts chapter 2, where it talks about, your sons and your daughters will prophesy, your young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. Well, I started really, going back looking at it, and back in, in Jeremiah and in Zechariah, and then in Joel, are these two different separate occasions? Because Jeremiah goes on and talks about these people that are prophesying and dreaming, but it's not from God, but they're saying it's from God. And then when you see in Acts, is it the same? Is it referring to the same people is what I'm asking?
Well, Peter is quoting from Joel. He's not quoting from Jeremiah.
Yeah, right? I know. He's Joel, too.
So, okay. So, what's the reference to Jeremiah?
Excuse me?
What was the reference to Jeremiah? I'm sorry.
Jeremiah, oh, goodness. What is it? 14. Verse 14. Actually, it might be a little bit above verse 14. Hold on, I gotta look it up. I love the computer. Look everything up. Quick.
But what was the question exactly? I didn't understand it. I'm sorry.
Excuse me?
I didn't understand
the
question.
Yeah, I don't really understand your question.
My question is about people who, false prophets. There's a lot of people who don't really understand what defines a false prophet. And that's one of the things, because, the Bible does warn about people who have false visions and false predictions and delusions of their own mind, but they're saying it's from God.
Uh-huh. Okay.
What are some of the to look for so people aren't deceived? Because there's a lot of that going on.
You were right about Jeremiah 14:14. The prophets prophesy lies in my name. I have not sent them, commanded them, nor spoken to them. They prophesy to you a false vision, divination, a worthless thing, and the deceit of their heart. Wow. I think for us in the modern day, the most the most secure thing that we can do is stick with the Bible. I think there is a time when the Holy Spirit will give you an impression. He'll direct you this way, he'll direct you that way. He'll maybe say, move to Timbuktu. You might feel that. But Paul says, look, if there's someone who's going to speak in a tongue, there must also be someone who is going to interpret. And he says that prophecy is actually better than speaking in tongues. But it has to be, just like everything, it has to be done by the mouth of two or three witnesses. So that has to be established. And, I think that the answer really that you're seeking is to go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and spend some time digging in there. Because Paul says, pursue love and desire spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. For he who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men but to God, for no one understands him. However, in the spirit he speaks mysteries. But he who prophesies speaks edification and exhortation and comfort to men. So, I think what happens, though, is we have people that are going around saying, hey, I'm prophet so-and-so, and, God's given me a special commission. And by the way, please, let's pass the hat again because I need it to go around twice. What happens is they become self-proclaimed prophets. Look, if I'm a prophet, then I should just keep my mouth shut about my title and go about doing the good work that God has called me to do. right? But what happens is people start to let their supposed title go ahead of them, and of course that's when pride begins to puff up. And if they don't have anything from the Lord, but now people are expecting them to have a word from the Lord, well, guess what? Now they suddenly want to start giving out prophecies left and right when there may not be a prophecy. You know, Jeremiah had a lot of dry times, as did Isaiah. I mean, look at Abraham, the father of the faith. You know, about 20 years went by between these encounters that he had with God. So, you know, people weren't getting a message every day in and out. You know, maybe Moses, certainly Moses is the exception where God speaks to him face to face. But the real key is that for whose edification is the prophecy? Is it to make the prophet look good, or is it really to bless the people? And more often than not, the prophets are forthtelling rather than foretelling. You know, they're not necessarily telling you the future. You know, next year at this time, you're going to have a baby. I mean, yeah, the prophets did that occasionally. That's pretty cool. But a lot of times it was, come back to me, my people, come back. You know, so that's a major job of the prophet, is to call the people back to what? Here's a key question. What is the prophet calling the people back to? Calling back to God, for sure, but also to his word, to his Torah. You know, the prophets were to point people back to the Torah. That was their main job. And so, you know, that's really what a prophet should be doing. That's my take on it.
Right. I do understand the gifts of God very well. My grandmother has the gift of tongues and interpretation. She's had it for a very long time now. It's the one thing that, you know, that you made mention of about the two or three witnesses, and that is one thing that I've always noticed is during the tongues and interpretation, there may be two or three that speak in tongues, but there's usually only one who interprets.
Uh-huh.
And it's the most amazing thing that I have ever felt in my life. There's nothing in comparison to it. It's when you can literally feel God move into the room, and children become quiet, and babies stop crying. There's like that moment of peace right before it happens. And you can literally feel the power of God all around you. That's like the one thing I was trying to point out to her, that, you know, not everybody who's telling her that they're a prophet are prophets, and that
yeah.
she should test everything to the Word of God.
Absolutely, yeah.
But she kept telling me about all these dreams that God was giving her, and I really didn't know how to answer her with that, because some of the dreams I can't find that in Scripture, so I couldn't really agree with her. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah, and, you know, I do believe that God speaks in dreams. I personally have not had any, but I've prayed for dreams, you know, and I've prayed for just an outpouring of the Spirit on my life, because I want everything that God has for me. You know, I don't want God to hold anything back, but I always want to test it against the things that he's already told me, right? So
right.
He's not going to contradict himself with a new word, you know, with something that he's already said in the given word. And
right.
So, you know, that always just has to be the litmus test. And I think we have to use some discernment. We have to be careful. We have to not get too far ahead. I don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater and say that, well, all those people who speak in tongues, you know, they're wrong. Because I don't believe that. I think people really do speak in tongues. You know, I have the gift of speaking in tongues. I don't manifest it a lot, if we can say that. But, you know, it's just one of these things that probably takes a lot more practice on my part to become, you know, efficient at it. But, you know, Paul even says, I'd rather you all speak one word in a known tongue than you know, all this in this gift of tongues if there's
right.
nobody there to interpret, right?
Exactly.
And, you know, my trouble when I'm trying to speak in tongues is I start thinking about the languages that I've studied, and I'm like, you know, I'm waiting for something kind of magical, and it doesn't really happen in, too much in my case. But I believe in the gift
of
tongues.
You and me are too intellectual, Doug Camp.
Yeah, and that's not a good thing, okay? I'm not
exactly
proud of that.
That's right.
You start hearing the linguistics of the language.
Right, you know, so, but, you know, I'm missing out, right? Because I want all the blessing that I can possibly get. Whatever God has for me, boy, I want that. You know, so I think sometimes finding that happy medium is, you know, it's kind of a trial and error. And, you know, some churches, like the Assemblies of God, have a tendency to really focus much more on the Spirit to their credit. But I think their discredit is that they have a tendency, and I'm speaking very broadly here, but they have a tendency to put less emphasis on the Word of God. And again, I'm speaking with big strokes here, so, you know, don't send me any hate mail. But you know, and there are other churches that really focus on the teaching of the Word, but boy, they're as dead as you can be. My goodness. So, you know, we've got to find that balance between the two, because God is still working through the Holy Spirit. He's still working. He's still giving impressions to people. But I mean, there was a time I went to a certain website, like almost every day. I won't say who it is, but and there were these kind of prophetic visions that you know, people were saying, and they're like, you know, by 2012 or by 2013, you know, this or that's going to happen, and it didn't happen. Right, and after a while, I'm like, you know, this is like the boy who cried wolf. I'm just not, you know, I can kind of put up with one or two, but after a while, you're like, oh, I'm wasting my time here. I'm gonna get back on to other things. So, you know, really, that's important. If these things come to pass, then you know it's legit. But if they don't, then certainly that person does not have the gift of prophecy.
Right.
My take on it is that, you know, there are people who think that they're getting prophetic words and they're saying what they, you know, genuinely believe or whatever, but it's up to us who hear it to be good Bereans and search these things out, to test the spirits to see whether they be of God and to see if it, you know, aligns with Scripture. And, you know, same thing a while back, I want to say back in 2003 through about 2005, I was really striving to understand the gifts of the Spirit, and I just flat out could not accept the doctrine of cessation because I saw no evidence of it in Scripture. In fact, John 14:12 seemed like a trump card to me to refute cessation. Anyone, not just Peter, James, and John, but anyone who believes in me will do the same works I've done and even greater works because I'm going to be with the Father. So I looked at that. I read through Acts and everything. I'm going, well, I don't see where this ended anywhere. All I see is that we're supposed to be doing this stuff. So I started seeking it, searching it, and going to places where I thought I could find it. And same thing, there were some of these churches that would have these so-called prophets show up. And it really became sort of a freak show, to be honest with you, because they would start talking about orbs and, you know, gold dust and feathers and all kinds of garbage. And you know, they're putting up pictures on the big screen saying, yeah, this last prayer meeting, look at all the angels that showed up. And they're saying that the orbs in the picture were angels. And I'm a filmmaker. I'm a photographer. I'm like, that's dust, you know, reflecting off of the flash of the camera. You know, Sheila and I even went to Israel with a group of these people, and we were in a Bedouin tent out there in the desert, and all around the campfire and praise and worship, people were taking pictures and stuff, and they're looking at their digital cameras, and they're like, look at all the orbs, look at all the orbs. And I'm like, okay, we're around a campfire in a dusty environment. Hello. And so I would go into random places and throw dust up in the air and take pictures. I'm like, look, orbs, look, orbs, look, orbs. And orbs are everywhere. But it was driving me crazy. And I went to this one church where they were talking about the gold dust and gold teeth and feathers and stuff falling from heaven and whatnot, as if angels are shedding everywhere. And while the guy's talking about this stuff, and he's got a picture of orbs up on the screen, this, it looked like a feather, came down from the ceiling, and the spotlight caught it. I mean, like everybody saw it. And this guy was really smooth because he was already talking about this stuff. And when he saw it, he goes, yeah, isn't it cool when that happens? So he's got the buy-in of the audience. Everybody's thinking this is an angel feather. I am totally not buying it, though. Well, where does that thing go? It lands right on my knee. It floated all over the place. The air vent blew it everywhere, and it landed right on my knee. And I looked at it, and it was just a piece of fiberglass that had fallen from the ceiling tile. Okay? It's ceiling tile. It's not a feather.
And that's one of the things, like you guys are saying about, you know, like always going back to the Word. I do not see that anywhere in the Word of God.
No, absolutely not. And that's what that's our responsibility is to, you know,
right.
Whatever
and that's
we hear
what,
this
you know,
say.
I have been in some churches that there's a difference. I mean, I had a young lady many, many years ago who openly admitted behind closed doors, like, you know, outside the church, that she would fake speaking in tongues. And sadly to say, shortly after admitting that, and she tried to get the teenagers. I was only a teenage girl. She was, you know, a few years older than I was, trying to get the teenagers to fake this just so the, you know, the adults would leave us alone type of thing. And about 5 years after that, she wrapped herself around the telephone pole. And prior to that, she was in and out of psychiatric centers. And the amount of demonic attacks that came against this woman were unreal. And that was, like, another question that I get asked a lot. A lot of people want to know how to basically put on the armor of God. How to really suit up, so to speak.
Okay, that's a good one. We'll go ahead and address that, and I'll remind our listeners that you can still call in 619-789-6815 if you have a question. What do you guys think? I've heard L.A. Marzulli talk about putting on the armor of God. What's your take on it?
Well, I can make a comment or two. Certainly each of the aspects of the armor, you know, you really have to look at the breastplate of righteousness and the helmet of salvation and the gospel of peace and all that, and understand the meaning of each of those things and understand the implication for, you know, knowing what that is about, you know. So I think that there's, you know, there is this sort of, Lord, you know, I pray that you will strengthen me and you know, I basically claim and take on the, you know, the armor of God. But for the most part, I think the way that the, you know, that the meaning of the scripture is to use it as an analogy to explain to us each of those things that provide for us assurance and strength when we are engaged in spiritual warfare. So I don't think it's necessarily a magic incantation or anything like that. I think there's a certain understanding of the scripture and the truth behind it that equips us to be capable of conducting spiritual warfare. But that's my two cents.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, spiritual warfare is really, it's not about, putting on some special clothing. In fact, Paul is actually borrowing from imagery from Isaiah about putting on the helmet of salvation. You know, it's really to be completely immersed in the Word, right? And knowing the truth. I mean, if you think about, you know, it's not so much that you put on some kind of a vestment, but that truth is that belt that you attach things to, right? And your breastplate of righteousness, well, guess what? That means to live righteously. Oh my goodness, some people might call that legalism. But it's not legalism. It's called righteousness. Rob and I were just talking about this today off the air. But, you know, I think somehow, in fact, Rob, I just read your article. It's very good on the law. I want to do similar thing. Yeah. But, you know, we've got this really weird, really funky idea of the law being some kind of an evil thing. And, gee, we're so glad that Jesus is now, he's now freed us from that onerous kind of thing, and we think that Paul is actually saying that, but Paul isn't saying. An example I like to use is, it's like the law of gravity. If you come up really close to a cliff, you're right up on the precipice, And for whatever reason, you know, the wind blows you off. Well, gee, now you're falling to your death. Or you had this crazy moment of insanity and you jumped off, now you're falling to your death. Or, you know, you were depressed and you just said, I'm going to kill myself, and you fall to your death. Or you're just like rebellious and you're like, I don't care what you say, I'm going to jump off this thing. It doesn't matter how you sinned. The point is, you're falling, and, you know, in so many seconds, depending on how far down it is, you're going to go splat. So, you know, you can be there, and there are other people falling with you. You can reform. You can say, gee, we should never have done this. Like, I agree with you. Why did we ever fall off or jump off this cliff? Really bad move. Totally agree with you. You know, I'm going to, from now on, I am not going to jump off any of the cliffs. I repent of that. You can do all that and be really nice to the people on the way down, but you're still going to go splat. So what you need is a savior. You need somebody who is bigger and stronger to graciously put his hand out and catch you. That's what you need. And so it's not that the law of gravity was bad. It's just if you violate that law, there is a natural consequence. And that's the same thing that happens with the law of God. It's not that God, you know, got this big book of the law and he put it on the shoulders of the Jews and he said, here, take that. Someday I'll take it away and boy, you'll be so happy. No, it really, all he gave him the instruction booklet. He said, look, you know, I just gave you a new car. Here's the instruction booklet. And it tells you how to take care of your car, right? Or you just get a new microwave and it says, you know, don't put metal in there. You're like, well, that's not fair. You're taking away my liberty. No, it's just telling you how the machine works. And God is simply, in his Torah, he's telling us how it works. He's not saying, you know, I've decided that you can do this, but you can't do that. And that's because, you know, I just randomly decided. He's like, no, this is how, this is the law of love. This is how it works in my universe, because that's the best and only way it can work. And I'm giving you the insider secrets. I'm giving you the secret hand guide so that you can know how to get through life with the most blessing and success. And somehow we're like, oh, boy, that thing is just so mean. But you see, the instruction manual never had the capacity to put the fire out after you put in the metal into the microwave. I mean, the instruction manual, the law, as it were, you know, once the fire is going, it can't do anything for you. You can throw it on the fire. It's going to keep on burning. You need a fire extinguisher is what you need. And that's essentially what Jesus is. Jesus says, okay, so you broke the law. That was dumb. But I'm here to help you. I'm doing it graciously. You don't deserve it, but I'm here to help. You know, so what, should we keep on sinning? Should we keep on breaking the law that sin may abound? By no means. And, you know, stop. Don't do it again. That's what we're talking about.
Yeah, amen. I've been posting a lot of stuff in this regard, and actually somebody just texted a question regarding, okay, when it comes to keeping the law, what are we talking about here? Are we talking about the Ten Commandments of Feast, the 613 commandments allegedly that are in the Torah? I know what my take on it is. What's your take?
Yeah, I'd be happy to. And Doug, let me jump in anytime you want, brother. But
yeah, this,
you know,
is very, you guys know, I'll listen in and comment later.
Okay. Yeah. You know, I mean, which of the Ten Commandments don't we like? I mean, you know, that's the first thing to ask. You know, which of those do we think we should be breaking? I mean, if there's any one, it would be number four, which is, of course, the Sabbath. But, you know, and I don't think we should be. I mean, all God is telling you to do is take a day off, will you? Really, I mean, take a day off. It's you know, I've told you, take a day off. But the other ones are, it says, look, you know, if you murder, guess what? There's going to be this awful imbalance in your life. You're going to feel terrible. You're going to have guilt. And, of course, not to mention the person you just killed, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, you know, there's so many things that if we start lying, guess what? It starts to ruin the fabric of society. If we're always stealing, who wants to live in a society where you're always getting ripped off? I mean, you know how quickly things will come to a halt if we live in that kind of society? We're going to turn into the mafia, and it's going to be, you know, survival of the fittest, truly. That becomes complete anarchy. Nobody wants to live in that because business does not thrive.
right? So, you know, if you're a really smart businessman, you like people with integrity because then you know that they're going to do what they say they're going to do. And you don't have to carry a gun. You don't have to be afraid for your life. You can actually, I mean, even if you're, you know, godless, you still want your business colleagues, et cetera, to have integrity because then you can trust them and they're going to do what they say they're going to do. So, and even taking a day off, God's like, you know what, if you don't take a day off, it's going to go bad for you. Not because God's going to zap you with his finger, you know, throw a lightning bolt at you. It's he's just like, you know, it, trust me, you're going to get burned out. You're going to start, you know, become obsessed with the wrong things. Things are going to go crazy in your family. It's going to go crazy for you personally. And, you know, you'll end up all alone, depressed, brokenhearted, suicidal. And you know, these are the things that happen if you don't take a day off. And, of course, your body can break down as well. So the law is very good, but the law never had the power to undo a violation of that law. That's not the purpose of the law. The law is simply the insider's guide on how to have a blessed life. That's all it is. But once you violate it, it can do nothing for you. It's powerless to do that. And if you start looking at the rest of the 613 laws, I mean, there's a lot of laws in there. Now, look, some of the laws that are for the Levites clearly will never apply for me because, and they didn't apply to the average Jew either because, right. you know, you're not in the temple service. So we can just already put those aside for now and not really consider those. But let's take something like putting a banister around your roof. You know, in the Middle East, they have flat roofs. You can go up there. You can have a party. That's, you know, somewhat akin to what we have in California. I see some of the fancy houses down by the beach, and, you know, they have a flat part of the roof. And guess what? They have a banister around that. And I'm like, oh, yeah, God said to do that. That's called loving your neighbor, right? Because when you put a banister up so that somebody can't fall off, it's called loving your neighbor. When you go to the Grand Canyon and they have a protective barrier, that's loving your neighbor. Right? And when you go across a bridge and they have a handrail there or something to keep you from falling off, that's loving your neighbor. You know, America actually does quite well. I've been to countries where they don't love their neighbor very well. And you're like, boy, I sure love those building codes back in America because, you know, it really helps you. I lived in Bolivia for a while, and the sidewalks are uneven because everyone builds their little portion of the sidewalk. And so you can't walk along, you know, and text at the same time. You know, that was before the days of texting.
Let me ask a question to you guys, because you guys are much closer to, you know, really trying to reconcile the teachings of the Torah with, you know, with, let's say, with the New Testament, have done more work in that area than I. But, you know, is there a legitimate distinction in talking about fulfilling the law by distinguishing some aspects of, let's say, the ceremonial or ritual aspects of the law, you know, the celebrating the feast days versus, in effect, the, let's say, the moral commandments of the law? Is it legitimate to distinguish between those two? The reason I ask that is that, you know, we are probably not too worried about being or keeping a kosher house. And yet, obviously, an Orthodox Jew would be very concerned about that. So could you comment on that?
Yeah.
Sure.
I'd be happy to.
Go ahead.
If you want to, Rob.
Okay. No, you go first.
Well, yeah, you know, again, it's, I mean, look, think about this, Doug. You know, you used to work for Microsoft, and did you ever take a day off during the week?
Yeah, boy, not without catching
that
flack.
What's that?
Not without catching a lot of flack and a lot of frowns, you know.
But you took a day off. You took at least one day off a week?
Every so often, absolutely.
Okay. Now, what if you know, Bill Gates had said, look, Doug, you know, Marta's in his office, I'm going to pay you to take one day off, or I'm going to give you 2 days. I'm going to give you 2 days off a week, and I'm going to pay you to do that. Would you show up at the office if he was paying you to not be there on those days?
Gosh, you know, I don't know. I don't know if I fully follow the question. I probably would have done what I felt the job required, regardless of whether or not Bill said he'd give me, let's say, a special payment for showing up.
No, for not showing up. No,
yeah,
see,
okay,
that's the
for
problem.
Not, he'll pay me if I don't show up. Oh, I guess he said, please don't show up, and I'll pay you for not showing up. I would say, sure,
right.
I won't show up.
Yeah. Now, okay, so that's essentially what God is doing. He's, look, I will pay you to not show up to work on Saturday. Okay, deal? And you're like, yeah, of course. He's like, I'll pay you double for that day. Okay, cool. And we'll just we'll spend the day together. We'll go to the park. We'll talk. You know, tell me what's on your heart. I'll tell you what I'm thinking. And it'll be a fun day. How does that sound? Yeah, okay. But then what happens is, you know, Friday, you know, because Shabbat starts on Friday evening. But at Friday around 5 o'clock, you're like, oh, my goodness, I have so much work to do. I just have to get this done, right? And then Shabbat comes. You're like, oh, my goodness, I still got so much work to do. I haven't finished it all, right? And there you are. You're now working on the day that God said, I'm going to pay you to take this day off, right? I want you to spend some time with me, spend some time with your family, you know, take a nap, go to the beach, you know, chill out in the pool, you know, just I don't know, just loaf around all day and don't do anything. But I'm paying you to take advantage of that day. And what happens is you start to feel, yeah, but I have so much work to do. You just don't understand God. And he's like, well, wait a second. I'm paying your salary. So, again, it's kind of like, you know, Bill Gates saying, look, I'm going to pay you to take a day off. And then you sneak into the office, and he catches you, and, you know, he says, what are you doing here? And you're like, but I have so much work to do. He says, but I'm the boss. Okay, you know, this is my company, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, mm-hmm. You know, if I want you to take a day off, and I pay you to take a day off, right? I mean, I'm not going to fire mm-hmm. you for not working today, right? So that's essentially what's happening, is God saying, look, just take a day off and I will pay you. So it baffles me, why are we, you know, in such a huff over this thing when God's like, just take a day off, what's the problem? Oh, and by the way, I want to give you not just one holiday, not just two holidays a year, I want to give you 7 paid holidays a year. How do you feel about that? You're like, wow, I get 1 holiday a week paid, and I get 7 paid holidays a year. You've got to be kidding me. No. And I'm going to take care of you. We're going to have a good time. I'm going to provide for you. And that's essentially what God is saying to do, right? And you know, it's been proven that if you don't take a day off, you kind of go cuckoo. I mean, just, you know, live it out in your own life, and, you know, your marriage starts to break down, your household starts to break down. Everything starts to go crazy if you don't take a day off, and you know, if
so,
you don't get the rest of the relaxation.
You know, maybe I'm the only one that isn't sure I understand your analogy. But are you suggesting this in regards to the wisdom of keeping the Sabbath, or are you? In other words, my question, for instance, might be: there's many laws in the Old Testament that are part of the Mosaic Law that have to do with certain rules and regulations regarding what we eat and don't eat and so forth. You know, are those also requirements for us to maintain, you know, that type of purity?
Can I answer that?
Well, yes, please, please, please.
First thing I would ask is, where would you see that any of those were repealed?
Okay. Well, I'm asking you guys, do you guys keep a kosher house?
Sheila and I certainly try to. Yes, when it comes to like
biblical kosher.
Like, yeah,
biblical
when it
kosher.
Yeah, not rabbinic. but
mm-hmm.
you know, when it comes to like, for instance, the dietary laws,
mm-hmm.
it doesn't take but a few clicks of the mouse pad, you know, and a Google search for you to find out that
mm-hmm.
pig is like really bad for you, and secular scientists
mm-hmm.
are telling you this. Same thing with shrimp and pretty much all the stuff God says, hey, you know, don't eat this stuff. Well, because he made stuff and he made you and he knows what's good for you and what's compatible for you and what's not. So, you know, even putting scripture aside, science is telling you this is bad for you. It will kill you and or make you really sick if you consume it on a regular basis. God kind of spares us all that by saying, hey, don't eat it. It's not, I don't consider it food and you shouldn't consider it food either. And, you know, I like bacon as much as the next guy and used to eat it quite a bit, actually. But, you know, as I started doing intentional Torah studies and saw stuff that where he makes declarations with feasts and holidays and different things, and he would say, "This is perpetual. It's forever. It's everlasting. You know, forever." I mean, he uses these words that don't indicate that they're going to someday end at the cross, as many a pastor will teach. And so, you know, as I looked at that, I said, "Well, okay." You know, he says, "Don't eat it." I'm not going to eat it. And, you know, it doesn't really hurt me to not eat it. Do I miss bacon every now and then? Sure. But, I mean, turkey bacon tastes almost the same. but it's better for me. So, you know, especially as I started to have some health issues, I started being more concerned with what I eat. And I thought, well, what if I try it God's way? You know, and like I said earlier, I see nothing in the scriptures, including Acts 10, that would indicate that those have been repealed. So I'm like, well, if they're still in effect and he put them there for my own benefit, for my own good, for my own health, why would I not want to do them? I guess is the better question.
Yeah. You know, and,
okay,
and
so you're
saying from a
practical standpoint, there are good practical and health and scientific reasons why the law of God is also very helpful to us from that perspective. And so I'm just trying to understand what I'm hearing you say is no, there's really not a distinction between, you know, certain portions of the law or the spirit of the law that in effect all 613 laws or whatever still apply.
Well, like Doug Hemp mentioned a minute ago, if you really get down to the 613 and start breaking them down and looking them up and, you know, identifying them, you'll find that not a single person, including Yeshua, Jesus Christ himself, could keep all 613. Nobody could, because there are some that were only applicable to priests that involved the temple and sacrifice. Well, Yeshua is not of the tribe of Levi, so he automatically couldn't keep those. He's not a woman. There are some of the 613 are only for women. Some are only for farmers. You know, so when you really get down to it, there's no way that any person on the entire planet, including our Savior, could have ever kept the 613. So I immediately dismissed the 613 argument. I'm like,
okay.
Well, if Yeshua couldn't keep all 613, why should I even think I could attempt to? And there's some that just simply flat out will not apply. But then there are other ones. You know, the Big Ten are the ones that I'm most concerned with. It's like, let's get those right.
Mm-hmm.
But the additional ones that are part of the 613 that I feel that do apply would be the continuation of the feasts, especially if you understand Romans 11, Ephesians 2, Revelation 21. You know, all these scriptures that tell us that when we receive Yeshua into our heart and become believers, that we are grafted into the cultivated olive tree that is Israel, that we are brought into the commonwealth of Israel. We are no longer strangers to the promises. All of these scriptures that tell us that we become spiritual Israel, well, then all of a sudden, all those things that he said would be perpetual forever from generation to generation to Israel, they apply to me. And then I go, well, okay, I mean, we do our Christmas thing and we do our Easter thing, and nobody ever says you're being legalistic for doing Christmas and Easter. But all of a sudden when you say, hey, let's do Passover, everybody's like calling you a legalist. And I'm going, I don't get it. Christmas and Easter have nothing whatsoever to do with our Savior. They were introduced by Babylon and Rome. And yet all of these other things have everything to do with our Savior. So why wouldn't I trade two pagan holidays for seven godly holidays that he said are forever and should be, you know, perpetual in our generations? So, and then of course it's a dietary. So for me, you know, the ones that I'm working on, let's say, and it has nothing to do with my salvation. I'm going to say that up front. I'm saved by grace through faith. It's not of works. I get it. Ephesians 2:8. Cool. But 1 John 5 says, this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. His commandments are not grievous. So do I love God? Yeah. Well, if I love God, then the definition of loving God, according to John, is doing the commandments. Which ones can I do? Well, I can't do any of the things that apply to Levites. I can't do any things that apply to women. Those are automatically out. What can I do? Well, I can eat right, practice the feasts that all relate to my Savior, that illustrate who he is, and I can do the 10 that help me to love God and love man. So that's where I'm at, if that makes sense.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
And a lot of the other laws, as I was pointing out, like, you know, keeping a banister, it's very practical. We'd call it a building code. right? There's also a law for not having any mold in your house. That's loving your neighbor, right? I mean, if somebody's allergic to mold, which most people are, then doing something about the mold in your house is loving your neighbor, right? I mean, those are the kinds of things that we're talking about. These are, yeah, they're not grievous. And even the things that, you know, don't seem to make, you know, all the sense in the world. I mean, God says, don't get a tattoo, right? I mean, it's like, well, you know, it doesn't mean that you're going to hell if you get a tattoo. It's just that you're going to miss some of the blessing that he has for you. I think the trouble is that we start assigning everything, you know, well, if you do this, then you're going to hell. It's like, well, no, I mean, that's not the point. The point is, now that we've been adopted into the family, we were adopted by grace. You know, God shows up at the orphanage. He says, I'll take you, you, and you. And we're like, really? Me? Why me? He's like, just because I want to, you know. He's like, great. So we go back home. And then, you know, he says, well, look, at the orphanage, you guys did something this way. But we're going to do it this way. You know, back at the orphanage, you guys were eating dog and rat just to survive, okay? But we don't eat that in our house because we don't consider that food. We consider that kind of like trash, you know. So we don't recommend that you eat dog and rat anymore because we think it's disgusting, all right? I mean, if you want to do that, please don't do it in our house. I mean, even the very thought of my son eating dog and rat is, it's an abomination. It makes me kind of queasy, you know.
Well,
and, you know, this
I'll eat bacon, and you can eat all the dog and rat you want, though.
Yeah, but see, the point, Doug, is that, you know, just as we don't consider dog and rat to be food, right?
Uh-huh.
I mean, we don't consider chilled monkey brain to be any kind of a delicacy, not in this country. You know, we're like, ooh, you know, that's absolutely disgusting.
Right.
The Jewish people never, ever have considered pork to be food. They're like, no, pigs
mm-hmm.
are not food. They're like rat. That's the
mm-hmm.
distinction. And you know, we've decided not to eat biblically. We've decided to eat biblically kosher. What we mean by that is, you know, the mixing of milk and meat. I don't consider that to be a biblical injunction. I think that's a rabbinic injunction
right.
that has been, you know, foisted upon the text. I don't think that's naturally drawn out of the text. So, you know, I still have, you know, chicken and cheese together because what are the odds that I'm ever going to have a kid boiled in this mother's milk when I'm having a chicken and cheese sandwich? I mean, the odds are zero, right? So, you know, that's the kind of stuff that the rabbis have added, maybe with
right.
good intentions, but, you know, it's not necessary. So, you know, that's the kind of stuff that we're talking about. And it's just, you know, God wants you to bless. He wants to bless you. He's like, all right, fine. If you want to eat that stuff, go for it. But, you know, don't be surprised when you come down with this, that, or the other, right? So it's like praying for somebody to be healed of lung cancer and then they go on smoking. You're like, really?
Right.
You've been healed of lung cancer, but you're going to continue smoking. Okay, I'm not going to pray for you again, you know? I mean, it just doesn't make any sense.
Okay, well, I think I understand better where you're coming from.
Okay, well, we have another caller in the queue, it looks like, from area code 931. Who do I have here?
Hi, Rob. This is Alan.
Hi, Alan. How you doing?
Hey, guys. Maybe if we could segue earlier in the show, talking about how if you just look at the scripture, what we call heaven is really lazy. Like, it's really going to be on earth in conjunction with the New Jerusalem. And the more I see that, the more I started questioning, is my view of hell scriptural? Like, we talk about hell like it's a certainty, and of course it is, but I guess I'm starting to have doubts in the sense that everybody's been so lazy about we're all going to go into the sky, into heaven, and you find out that's not really what the Bible says. Just, I mean, like, for instance, the idea of it, Jesus using Gehenna comes from Ben Hinnom, which is where Moloch would be sacrificed to, which is Nimrod. And then that's what gets thrown into the lake of fire. And there's verses about, you know, people being in outer darkness. And then I assure you there will come Gentiles from all over who sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But you, for whom the kingdom was reserved, you know, you'll be far away. And I'd also throw into the the idea. I'm also really struggling with, okay, if God married Israel at the first Shavuot back in Exodus and not in Acts, okay, I'm just, who went and who's going to hell from Cain and Lamech and Tubal-Cain and Nimrod's a weird character, but, you know, Canaan, people that we know didn't have any sort of belief, but even that belief, like, they didn't have any direct belief in Yeshua as the Messiah. It's like we've heard talk of Genesis 3. We know there's a promised seed. But the same specifics that Christians use today and say, well, there's no other name under heaven. Got to say Jesus. Like, people didn't know the name Yahushua in the time of Abraham. So more of a question is, has your guys' understanding of what hell is it getting more biblical? And if so, does it challenge, like, a common thing that is normally said? I'm not questioning the existence of hell. I just want to be more scriptural.
Very good question.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, that's a really excellent question. And you're right. I think we are very lazy. In Mark 9, Jesus talks about how it's better to, you know, get rid of your eye rather than being cast into this place where the worm does not die and the fire is not quenched, which is commonly called Gehenna. And he's getting that from Isaiah. Now, you know, of course, you know, he's the one that said it in the first place, but he is quoting directly from Isaiah 66:24, and it says, "And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another and from one Sabbath to another, all flesh shall come to worship before me, says the Lord, and they shall go forth and look upon the corpses of the men who have transgressed against me, for their worm does not die and their fire is not quenched, and they shall be an abhorrence to all flesh." So this is really the heart of it, is that there is going to be a place visibly, not far away.
You're hitting on it.
And in Revelation 14:10, it says that those that took the mark, that they will be tormented in the presence of the Lord and of the holy angels forever. It also says in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 7 and 8, it says that when the Lord Jesus comes back in flaming fire, those who, he says,
obey not the gospel.
Yeah, actually, excuse me, 2 Thessalonians, my bad. 2 Thessalonians, and to give you who are troubled rest with us when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on those who do not know God. These shall be punished with everlasting destruction. Now here's the key. It says, from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. Now the trick here is that the word from is the word apo in Greek, and it has two different meanings. One can be what we call an ablative usage. That is, the man came out from the library, okay? You know, to leave a particular location. The other is a genitive use of it, where we're using it as essentially, you know, you could say he died from smoke inhalation, right? Or it's by virtue of. So these people, they're not going to be punished with this everlasting destruction apart from the presence of the Lord, but it's actually they're being destroyed on account of the presence of the Lord, an account of the glory of his power. And once you put that in context with so many other verses, it begins to blow your mind. And I've actually started in a few of my PowerPoints. I've touched on this, but I want to do a whole thing just on hell. But it says in Daniel 7 verse 11. Daniel says, "I watched them because of the sound of the pompous words which the horn was speaking. I watched until the beast was slain and its body destroyed and given to the burning flame." Well, this is exactly the same thing that's happening in Revelation chapter 9 when Jesus comes back and he gets the Antichrist, hence the beast, the Antichrist. This is, the same person here. And he's given to the burning flame. Well, if we go back up just one or two verses, in verse 9 it says, I watched till thrones were put in place and the ancient days were seated. His garment was white as snow. The hair of his head was pure wool, was like pure wool. His throne was a fiery flame, its wheels a burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. So there's fire coming out of God. We see the same thing in Ezekiel 1:26. We see in Isaiah 30:33 that Tophet, that is Gehenna, it's kindled by the breath of the Lord. There's so many verses that tell us that Gehenna is not this place far, far away. It's not this lake of fire that God, you know, a long time ago said, what can I do with those sinners? Let's see. Oh, yeah, I know. I'll make a lake of fire. I'll put a bunch of lava together and just throw them in there and let them be in there forever.
Just to add to that, I mean, in Matthew 25, he says it was originally created for Hasatan and the fallen angels.
Exactly. Right.
But go ahead.
Yeah.
I mean, I know you're but that's significant.
Yeah, totally, of course. Yeah, but see, really, if you start looking at the world beyond the veil, okay, there's kind of like a force field between our domain and God's domain. And if once that veil or the force field comes down, that's when Jesus is revealed, he's unveiled, and he comes back in flaming fire. And we also see from passages like 2 Kings chapter 6 when Elisha and his servant are surrounded. Elisha prays, Lord, open the young man's eyes, and he sees horses and chariots of fire on the mountains all around. So you see, the medium of that realm is fiery. Just like fish are in a medium of water, we are in a medium of air. In that realm, it's a fiery kind of realm. It's a, you might call it plasma or something like that. And the plasma is from God himself. And the angels, the good angels, are enveloped in this. They're like, yeah, you know, it's no big deal. It's like a fish in the ocean. They're like, what water? What are you talking about, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But the moment that a fish is taken out of that into a different environment called air, suddenly it's hell, right? And so when we get our new bodies, it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 that everyone is going to be judged, their works will be judged, because we will all be tested by fire. And
correct.
If anyone's works are burned up, he will be saved, yet as though through fire, it says. Now, for the unbeliever, they're going to be exposed to the exact same fire that you and I are exposed to. It's just the only difference is they don't have a new body. They don't have a body that can endure that fire.
If I can, you're probably about to answer it, but I'm totally tracking. I'm having the same thoughts, and I've heard you share some of this, and this is awesome. I appreciate all the verses. But the other thing is, if you could include, obviously we know that the subset that's not even written in the book of life to begin with is only that subset that's going to take the mark of the beast in the last days, won't be able to die, and it's going to be thrown alive. But if you could also touch on, yes, but let's take our friends right now who are dying without Yeshua that won't even be in that final tribulation phase. Like, talk about the difference between those who are resurrected. Obviously, we're all getting resurrected. Some will be put in new bodies. Some will still be alive because they're Nephilim. They've taken the mark of the beast. But then there's those, like our friends who die right now and our grandparents that don't believe. Is that too confusing? Can you cover that as you're going along?
Yeah, I'm tracking with you. Well, it's kind of like the rich man and Lazarus, right? The rich man died. He went down to this place of torment. And, I've thought about that a long time. I sometimes think, well, maybe, you know, hell is only for those who take the mark of the beast. But then I keep seeing, I see all these, you know, Luke chapter 16 there where Jesus talks about the rich man that went down to that place of torment. I don't know how to get around that. So, you know, if there's something, you know, if somehow after, you know, a couple years they get snuffed out, great, but I don't see that in Scripture. That's the only problem. So let me ask this.
Yeah. I'll ask this of Doug Woodward as well. Do you believe that the place where the rich man was in this story, Well, first of all, I'm going to assume that you guys believe that that's a real story. It's not just a made-up fairy tale that Jesus was telling. Right. Assuming that it is a real story, do you believe that the Hades that was spoken of there where the rich man is actually in the earth itself, as the Greeks and the Sumerians and the Egyptians believe?
Yeah, well, that's, boy, fascinating question, of course. And, you know, I say that for the most part, I guess I would say that, I don't know, you know, personally. I haven't studied it adequately to say, hey, I know it's for sure that way. But, you know, most of the scholars that I've read tend to believe that, you know, there is some kind of sort of location within the earth. And, you know, whether or not it's in effect, you know, sort of physically in the earth, or it's just sort of dimensionally within the sphere, I don't know exactly how to articulate that. But and by your statement that, you know, that this is a real story, obviously what you're saying is not, hey, did Jesus really teach this? We believe that he did. The question is, did he mean it to be interpreted not just as an allegory, but as a, you know, as a statement of fact, that there is this place that was called the bosom of Abraham, there's this place called Sheol, there's a chasm or gap between where the righteous stayed versus where the unrighteous were held, you know. So yes, the answer is yes. I believe that was asserting a certain cosmology that is true. Now, a different question is when the Lord was resurrected and he took captivity captive, were those places sort of transformed or changed? Was the quote-unquote bosom of Abraham eliminated, and so on? And I haven't studied that. I suspect that you guys have, but that's my understanding, is that the cosmology did sort of change post-resurrection.
Yeah, Doug Hamp and I have already recorded Quest4Truth 21, 22, and 23. I've got to get them edited and up. And we're in Revelation 6, and of course the fifth seal talks about the souls that are under the altar. And and Doug might maybe to elaborate on this as well, but my feeling is that Yeshua did liberate Abraham's bosom, and that he brought them, I believe, up as a first fruits offering, so to speak.
Yes.
So
I
believe that there's a three-compartment place in the earth that virtually every ancient culture referred to by different names, Argartha and whatnot, but that there's the good portion of it that was Abraham's bosom, there's the bad place where the rich man was, and then
there's the prison...
Tartarus underneath. I believe Yeshua liberated Abraham's bosom, but I think Tartarus and the rich man location is still occupied.
Hey, Rob, I'm down with that. But would you say Adam and Methuselah were part of Abraham's bosom, or
I believe
only
so.
Those?
Yeah.
Who, okay.
No, I
okay.
believe. Well,
See,
I believe
that's
those who. I believe those who fell into the category of, you know, they believe God and it was counted unto them as righteousness, those would be the ones that I would say, yes, they were, you know, pre-law, pre-cross, pre-all of that. There was some accounting that God understands. I don't pretend to understand, but that would have guaranteed them the spot in Abraham's bosom.
Yeah, you know, the Bible talks about the righteous. I mean, these are people that do what's right. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And they had a very elementary understanding of someone called the Promised One, you know, that was going to come, the seed of the woman. I doubt that most ancient people were thinking about the theological intricacies of all this. And they're like, you know what, I believe in Jesus, in Yeshua, you know. All they knew was they needed salvation, okay, which is, of course, what his name means, right? So if you're looking to God, the Creator, right, you don't know all this deep theology, you've never read the Westminster Confession and all this, all you've done, you know is, well, hey, there is a Creator. I know he loves me, and, you know, I've done all I can to serve him, to live for him, to please him, and I'm trusting that he's going to do the right thing. I'm trusting that he has the power to save me from the grave, right? That's what these people were trusting. And isn't that what we're trusting? We're trusting that God has the power to save us from the grave and to give us, you know, a resurrected body, a.k.a. eternal life, right? So they didn't know how he was going to do it. They didn't know this huge plan and this big scheme that the devil had and that, you know, through the cross that God was going to overcome all these different obstacles. They had no idea about all this stuff. And
we can infer when Christ said, "Abraham saw my day," we at least know that he may have had a little more vision, but those other guys, I can't find any verses that hint at it, that anybody before Abraham.
Well, you have the Hall of Fame in Hebrews 11. You know, various people were considered men of faith.
I'm sorry. Yes, of course. Yeah, thank you. Yes, that. I'm just saying, like, specifics of this deep understanding of atonement.
Yeah, you know, I want to go back to something Doug Hamp was saying, and see if I can wrap my head around this, because I do agree with you, Doug, when you're talking about the environment that God seems to swim in, if we can use the analogy, is fire, and I guess that's the reason why we have to. I mean, even the pillar of fire that followed them around in the wilderness. I mean, you know, we have these analogies over and over again. But when we are fully immersed in his presence, unless we have the new body, that's the reason why we have to get the new body. The new body is like the wetsuit that enables us to go into the depths of the ocean. You know, if you don't have that wetsuit, you're going to drown or you're going to be crushed. So those who don't have that new resurrected, glorified body, resurrected to that, those who get resurrected without that, they're going to get consumed in the environment that God swims in, if I can use that terminology. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, I mean, exactly. I mean, and even just to go beyond that metaphor, you know, instead of getting the wetsuit, it's actually you become a fish, you know, because now you're not just like, you know, kind of prepared for the water. You are one with the water, right? You're like, you're designed for it. You know,
right.
So you need to have some kind of a bodysuit, a body, right, that says, oh, I like the water. This is great, right? I mean, you know, we humans can put on all kinds of external kind of gear, and we can, you know, we can do it, but it's pretty tough, you know. But a fish, you know, a fish is no big deal. And that's why, like you said, having that new body is imperative, because in order to be in God's presence, you need a body that is able to stand, to endure that fire. And, you know, this is why one of the things that I'm going to talk about in Austin is what happens at the second coming. It's when that veil goes away, then the fire of God is now manifest upon the planet. And that's why the guys are shaking in their boots saying, oh, my goodness, the day of his wrath has come, and they go running off to the caves and the rocks, and they say, fall on us and hide us from the wrath of him who sits on the throne, right? I mean, these guys are all tough in Revelation 16, like, oh, yeah, we can take him, right? But then suddenly God opens up the sky, and they're like, we are dead. And they're not joking. They're not exaggerating. They're like, we're in big trouble, right? Because they finally realize, you know, who is the King of Kings? I mean, they still put up a fight, but, you know, but it's over at that point.
Yeah, well, it's about over at this point for us as well. We got about 2 minutes left in the broadcast. So I did want to get one more thing in, and I wanted to hear this from Doug Woodward. I'm familiar with most of the talks that you're going to be doing in Austin,
mm-hmm.
but the one that I'm not familiar with is the blood on the altar. Can I give us a brief overview of that?
Yes, I was invited along with about 8 or 9 other authors to contribute a chapter. Our brother Doug Krieger and I adapted a chapter from our book, The Final Babylon, for a book that's being edited and published by Tom Horde, and it's called Blood on the Altar, The Coming War of Christian versus Christian. And it deals a lot with the the whole issue
Facebook?
Of the kind of it's a book. It's not no Facebook. No, I don't know. It's from Defender Publishing, I'm sure, and Tom Horn, and we're dealing here with the what we jokingly call the submergent church, which is basically a sort of the I kind of call it neo-evangelicalism, which is a notion that it really comes from the evangelical sort of scheme of things, but it really downplays a lot of traditional doctrines, certainly eschatology, classical soteriology, many of the things that we're talking about tonight. Those folks that are in the sort of emerging church would kind of scratch their heads and wonder, what in the world are we talking about? So anyway, this book is going to be coming out. It's probably going to be very controversial. Should be in the marketplace on July the 15th, and I will speak to a chapter I wrote on the topic of when the Antichrist appears, probably in America, which is what we argue, will Americans, even will evangelicals, be able to recognize him? And my answer is, generally speaking, no.
Interesting. All right. Well, you know, I'm really excited about this conference coming up in August, and Austin in July.
In Austin in July.
Yeah. Right. Austin in July, and hopefully, you know, maybe New York later in the fall, and a few other cities across the country, and maybe even the world. Who knows? But thank you, gentlemen, for coming on tonight and helping out with this little test here to expand Quest4Truth into a Q&A with the audience and all that. And hopefully we can do more of it in the future.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks, guys, and thank you, everybody, for listening to the Revolutionary Radio Project and this sort of extended edition of Quest4Truth. And as we say on Quest4Truth, stay on the quest. Read your Bible. Good night, everybody.